Hey y'all, my name is Susan Sparks and I'm the senior pastor here at Madison Avenue Baptist Church in New York City. We are a diverse community brought together by faith. We hope that you enjoy our service today. Before I start my sermon this morning, I just wanted to add a little tag from last week. For those of you who were here last week, we all heard a sermon that was a pretty hard-hitting sermon on race in America and on the topic of reparations. And the homework that I gave all of us was to educate ourselves on this topic, to go out, to do some reading, to understand what does reparations mean, what might it look like, what are the options on the table. And I just wanted to make sure that you knew in this week's e-blast that just went out on Wednesday that I gave three different articles from the New Yorker and two from the New York Times as suggested reading. If you don't get the e-blast, just ask me and I'll send you the articles or email us and we'll put you on the e-blast, either way. And it's just a way, I want to make sure we keep this conversation going. So be aware that that information was in the e-blast, or write me and get it, and we'll keep talking. This sermon today is a bit different. It is on a completely different topic, and it is much shorter, and it is a lot more about me. Be scared. It is called The Look Homeward Angel. We all have angels in this life. I mean, some of them are literal, like this gigantic bronze angel that hangs over the back of the church. I'm sure you guys have noticed as you walk in the door. It's dedicated to one of this church's benefactors, Jeremiah Milbank, and it watches over our congregation. And then sometimes angels are more figurative, like people or things that make us feel cared for, things that guide us. And when I was little, I had an angel that was a combination of the two. It was a giant granite angel in the Oakdale Cemetery in Hendersonville, North Carolina. And the image of it's on the front of the bulletin. I just wanted you to be able to see, have a visual of the actual angel I was talking about. We would pass that angel, me and my mom and dad, at the end of our 135-mile drive from Charlotte, North Carolina, up to my grandparents' farm in the mountains of North Carolina near Hendersonville. And that drive included miles and miles and miles of really curvy mountain roads. Now, the problem is I tended towards severe car sickness. Jamie, I'm looking at you on this one. Yeah. So let's just say those mountain roads were not my friend. But that angel was my friend, because as soon as that angel came into view, I knew the curves were over. I knew the road would straighten out, and I knew I would live to see another day. When I was little, I always thought of that statue as the stop throwing up angel. But in fact, it had another more significant title, for it was known as the Look Homeward Angel. The author, Thomas Wolfe, grew up in Hendersonville, North Carolina, and the title of his famous novel, Look Homeward Angel, was based on that angel. Now, many of you probably read that book in school about a young man's struggles with his family and his move to find a new life, to find a new home. I mean, I've always loved my mother's take on the book. She was always so good at just cutting to the chase. Every time we passed the angel, she would say, "Now, you know that angel's famous. It was inspired a novel by a very important writer from these mountains named Thomas Wolfe." "Well, what's it about?" I would ask as the dutiful daughter, and she would give the same answer every time. And she always would answer it in the tone that she used when she was describing people that she thought were snotty. She'd say, "It was about a man who did not like North Carolina. So he moved up north." And then she would drop her voice to a whisper, "To New York City." And she'd stare out the window for a minute, shaking her head, adding, "He had problems." And there, in 17 seconds, is the novel, Look Homeward Angel. You're welcome. Thank you, Mom. The funny part was that after years of indoctrination on the evils of Thomas Wolfe, I too would leave North Carolina in search for home and move up north to Shakara, New York City. But even though I moved to the towering cement mountains of Manhattan, I still yearn for the real mountains that surround that angel. I mean, it was in those mountains that I learned to fish and hunt. And I spent my days rolling down big old bald mountains and riding horses and climbing trees and looking for arrowheads, and turned into the little, you know, cowboy boot wearing preacher that I grew up to be. And it was in those mountains that six generations of my Scots, Irish, German relatives were buried. I mean, this was the place I felt my deepest sense of home. Now, why am I sharing this story? Besides the fact I love to talk about myself in public. Because I believe that we all have our look homeward angel. A person or a place or a thing that grounds you, that defines who you are, that gives you a sense of self and place and belonging. I mean, who or what or where is your look homeward angel? Maybe you know, and that's great, but maybe you don't. Maybe you are sitting here today or listening today, searching for your look homeward angel. Maybe you're in a place in life where you feel like I did as a little kid going through those curvy roads, a transition perhaps. Maybe you've just moved here, or sadly, are moving somewhere new. Very huge sad face, BJ. Maybe you're in a relationship transition or a life transition, or maybe you're facing a loss. To be without a place of grounding is such an unsettling feeling. It's like that quote in our bulletin from Proverbs 27:8, like a bird that strays from its nest is one that strays from home. My message today is a simple one. If you are searching, do not despair, because we all carry a look homeward angel with us. Now, before you click off the podcast or the video because you think I've gotten too Hallmarky, stay with me. Because I want to share this extraordinarily cool story from 3,000 years ago from the book of Amos. You got to hear this. And then if you want to click it off, feel free. Okay. BJ read this great scripture for us today. And the story is set around 750 BC, a time of much peace and prosperity for the Israelites. But Amos, the great prophet, argues that in this time of prosperity, for some, Israel was going in the wrong direction. In fact, in Amos chapter 5, a little before our scripture, God says that the Israelites, quote, oppress the innocent, take bribes, and deprive the poor of justice in our courts. Does that sound familiar? Like our own headlines? Amos warns that God's judgment is coming because his people were failing to live by God's standards of justice and righteousness. So he pleads with God to spare his people. And in that moment, God does something so merciful and, I think, so creative. You know, God could have said, okay, fine, I'll spare them. Or God could have said, oh no, I'm striking all of you with lightning. But God didn't do either. God appears to Amos beside a wall, right? And that wall is built with a plumb line. Now, you probably know what a plumb line is, but if you don't, it's used in construction and building, and it's a weight that's suspended from a string or a line, and it's used for vertical reference. So it's the gravity on the weight that keeps the string tight and straight and ensures that a structure is centered. So God says, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people, Israel, and I will never again pass them by. I mean, how beautiful is that image that God has just planted God's self in the midst of her people and promises never, ever again to pass them by. It's like the lyrics, actually from both of our pieces of music today, the one that's coming and the one that was just sung, but I'm thinking of our anthem, the beautiful words, after all I've been through, who on earth can I turn to? I look to you. Brothers and sisters, that image is not just for the Israelites from 2,700 years ago. That image is for us too. God has placed a plumb line in our hearts, a guide that ensures we are centered, a presence that will never leave, a weight of a promise that God will never again pass us by. Once a year or so, I go back to Hendersonville and the farm and the North Carolina mountains. And when I do, I usually find myself driving by the Oakdale Cemetery. And when I see that angel, I'm always so happy. I mean, partly because I stop feeling nauseous. But I think most of all, I'm happy for the memories that that angel brings. And while I like to think that I've carried that angel with me throughout my life, the truth is that angel has carried me. Where do you find your look homeward angel? Where do you find your grounding and centering? If you don't know, don't worry. Because even in the worst of circumstances, in the transitions and the pain and the rejection and the abandonment and the anger and the loneliness, in the times where we feel lost, in the times where, like those curvy roads, we have no idea what we should be doing or where we should be going, remember, God is anchored in our hearts as our own personal look homeward angel. An angel that carries us when the road gets rough. An angel that cares for us when the road gets curvy. An angel that guides us, making sure that every day we are headed in the right direction. An angel that ensures we are looking toward home. And the people said, amen.
We pray for blessings. We pray for peace. Comfort for family. Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering.
And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise?
Wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near.
We doubt your goodness,
we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough.
Blessings come through raindrops.
What if your healing comes through tears?
And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life
are your mercies in disguise?
When friends betray you,
that this is not our home. It's not our home. It's not our home. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments, or the aching of this life, is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life,
the rain, the storms, the hardest nights,
are your mercies in disguise?
Like, I have a baby and no mama up here. Take him. He's yours. Well, we have a new member of Madison Avenue Baptist that showed up, and I wanted to make sure everybody got to meet him. Y'all know Tamron, and this is new baby Moses. Say hey, everybody. Hey, Moses. Yay! I've got my hands full, Tamron, but there is a Bible sitting right there with little Moses' name on it at the corner. BJ, would you give that? It's a little gift from Moses, presented from Madison Avenue Baptist Church. It's not as good as a pacifier or nice, wonderful food, but you'll like it down the road. Yes. May we say a little prayer together?
Yes,
please let us pray together. Gracious God, we ask your blessings on this beautiful young man and his family. We ask you to bless Stephen and Tamron as parents and bring them patience and love. And we ask you to bring many blessings on this beautiful young man. May he have a long life, and may you give him many gifts so he may do your work in this world, and he may be blessed and strong and true from this day and forevermore. Amen. Thank you. Oh, my goodness. Yes. And that's our benediction right there. We're really glad that you guys came to be with us on this really special Sunday to be able to meet little Moses, and we're going to meet Ava soon too. Churches are growing. This is always a place that you'll be considered family and that you will always be considered a friend of our community. And until we see you again, may God bless you and keep you, and may God bring strength to you and peace in your life. And as we leave through those doors, let us always remember, no matter how hard things get, we carry deep in our heart our own personal Look Homeward Angel. Amen.
Thanks for joining us. Madison Avenue Baptist Church is located at 31st and Madison Avenue in New York City. Our website is www.mabcnyc.org.